Amen. Thank you. And as our sister prayed for me in Singapore, the rain started coming. So I know the anointing has come. So I appreciate that very much, my sister. As we have been also virtual for quite a few months now, we always introduce ourselves with this, from our home to your home. And so we're honored to be here. Pastor David, thank you for the gracious invitation to allow me to come and to share the word of God with you. The title of this morning's message is called Kingdom Peace. That's almost the last thing all of us are seeing or understanding as we look across the world. I know David and I, Pastor David and I, have kept up with each other as far as Singapore and Norway. We are very close in the line in many, many ways, size and just some of the commonalities. But the number of our cases has dramatically increased. And for many weeks, Norway was way ahead of us, and so we were a little bit envious, but now we've five times as many as you have now. We have 40,000. So it's, as I've been looking not only at Norway, but all across Europe, I think the last thing people are experiencing is peace, whether it was Italy, Spain, the UK, Germany, Norway, Sweden. You can go on and on and on. And all across the West, as well as the East as well. So I'm going to encourage you that you would open up your hearts this morning to God's holy word, that you never hear these words put together, kingdom, anxiety. Those two do not go together. Kingdom, peace does. If you have your Bibles, I'd like for you to open up to Matthew chapter 6. This is the Sermon on the Mount. And a familiar passage, but I think it's a timely word as well. Verse 25, when Jesus, in that middle of that chapter, he starts off with the word therefore. And then he says, do not worry about our life, about what we shall eat or what we shall drink, nor our body. Don't worry about our body, about what clothes we should put on. And then he says, is life more than food and the body more than clothing? And so he's going to challenge us. And so as we open up God's word today, I'm going to challenge you to open up your heart as well. As my sister prayed, not only be hearers of the word, but be doers as well. So let's see what worry does before we get into the word of God. Worry divides the mind. Won't you hear that again? Worry divides the mind. The word worry shows up six times between verse 25 and verse 34. And I want to give you a brief explanation of what worry is. It actually is a combination of two words in the original language. The first word, we get our English word meridian, which means to divide. The second word comes from mind. So if you put the two together, you would have a mind that's divided, or a divided mind. If that doesn't resonate so much well with you, maybe something like this. Maybe your spirit is scattered or your focus is fractured. But whatever it does, it turns your heart and your mind away from the things of God. That's exactly what worry does. Now, this divided mind, I love the German word for worry. It's Sorgen. And Sorgen, it speaks of being choking or strangling. If you look in Mark chapter 4, you look at the parable of the seed and going into each soil. In the third soil, it speaks of the word of God coming in, but the worries of the world choke and strangle the actual the word of God, where it's unfruitful and unproductive. So when we have a divided mind, a fractured focus, or a scattered spirit, that means that we actually turn away from God, and it chokes the word and the life of God out of us. Before we get into the text, I want to give you a common example, a biblical illustration of worry that I think many of us can identify with either one or two of the characters. They're sisters, Mary and Martha. Many of you know the story well in Luke chapter 10. The two sisters are meeting with Jesus, and Mary is sitting down listening to Jesus teach the word. Martha, on the other hand, is having what we would call in the 21st century a mental meltdown, maybe an anxiety attack, we would call it in psychological terms. But whatever it might be, you can almost picture the kitchen, right? The scurrying about, the boiling of vegetables, the basting of the lamb, maybe the preparation of the salad, whatever it is. And then Mary is then told by her sister, you can almost get that sense that Martha is more of the forceful, the verbal, and she tells Jesus, get her to help me, get my sister to help me. Well, Jesus, I love his response. He's not really impressed by her busyness. I want you to hear that. He's not impressed by Mary's and Martha's busyness, nor is he intimidated by her command. But I love how Jesus turns to Martha and he says her name, Martha, Martha. Now, first of all, when Jesus knows our name, that's good. But then he calls you by name. And when he calls you by name, that first one should get your attention. So there's a cognitive response, like a mental, like, oh, he's talking to me. But when Jesus repeats your name, it's almost like he digs further and he unveils the heart. And he says, Martha, why are you worried? And remember what the word means? Why are you divided in your thinking? Why do you have a fractured focus? Why is your spirit scattered all over the kitchen? And Mary is doing the one thing. And that one thing is actually what is the opposite of having a divided mind. And so the word of God tells us now that worry is a divided mind. And that worry is a sin. That worry takes your focus off of God. And us in COVID-19, there's so many things to worry about, right? There's health. There's a spike in cases where things have been let go. There's where the governments have put more pressure on. There's sense of hopelessness, jobs lost here in Singapore. We have so many people have lost jobs. And so we see the government pouring billions of dollars into the economy. We see that in Europe as well. We see that in U.S. We see that all over the world. And so there's a global panic. The travel is there. There's restrictions. There's all kinds of things that are just hanging in the balance. And so we know what worry is. And so let's see what God says in his word. So open up your Bible in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 25. And the first command is remove worry from your mind. Again, I mentioned that the word worry shows up 6 times in this passage, but 3 times it's mentioned, it's actually a command. It tells us not to worry. 3 times, verse 25, verse 31, and verse 34. So it's not an optional for us as Christians. So if we break that and we worry, we actually break the commandment of God. Now, I don't know if you know this or not, but in Singapore, there is actually a law that says you have to wear a face mask. And if you don't wear the face mask, in fact, I was out running today, not in the rain, it was a little bit earlier, but there was actually policemen out checking people's face masks. And the first offense is $300. Second offense, you ready for this? $10,000. So when you break a law here, it's very severe, but how much more should we pay attention to the command of our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords? And 3 times he tells us in these 10 verses, do not worry. And this passage comes right after, if you remember, comes right after. It says, don't set your heart on the things like the treasures of this earth. But set your things, your treasures should be, your heart should be set on the things in heaven. So he's talking about the riches and the plenty, which I think Singapore and Norway can identify with. But now he goes to the other extreme. When he tells us not to worry and remove that worry, but what's he dealing with? He's actually dealing this command with daily essentials, with the things that we consider basics, such as food, water, and shelter. And these are the things that we shouldn't worry, our clothing. Now, in Singapore, when everything went crazy, the people went to the store to purchase things, and there were long queues. And the 2 items, and even the prime minister said, don't worry about these 2 items. But they mentioned, ready for this? Toilet paper? Obviously all global. But here in Singapore, guess what was buying out second? It was noodles. Okay? So those are essentials in Singapore. So I don't know what it would be in Norway. But what Jesus is talking about is he says, these essentials, don't worry about. That God will take care of them. And so he gives us divine counsel, verse 25. He says, do not worry about this. And then he makes this analogy. He says, don't worry about life, your very existence, about what you shall eat and what you shall drink. Don't worry about what your body, about your clothing. And then he tells us that God will take care of this. Isn't life more than food and drink? Isn't the body more than clothing? So the counsel is this. If our purpose of existence, this obsessive compulsive thing of making sure that we have enough food, making sure we have enough water. The guy in Australia bought enough toilet paper that will last 30 years. So it's these essentials that we think we need. But that's not the purpose of our existence. It's not the be all and end all. It's this physical survival. We have a spiritual existence. We have a heavenly existence awaiting for us as well. So when we worry about these things, God says, shouldn't be our focus. And so he's going to give us illustrations. And those illustrations are going to come up because he's going to give us from nature. And this is why I've got the scene behind me where we'll at least see outside. And he's going to bring 2 illustrations. And the 2 illustrations will first demonstrate and illustrate don't worry about your life. And second, don't worry about your body. So let's look at verses 26 and 27. Then he says, look, pay attention. I want you not only not to worry, but I want you to pay attention to the birds. And I was just watching some of the birds out there. I wish they would just fly by where you can kind of see the visual image. But he says, look at the birds. They neither sow nor reap, nor do they gather in barns. He says, not only do they not gather in barns, he says, but your Heavenly Father feeds them. And if your Heavenly Father feeds them, will he not do the same for you? And so God's word is telling us very, very clearly that he's got this under control. And he uses an illustration of a bird. And in fact, before we get to that, the word look means not just to glance, but to look with intention, to lean in, to learn. These birds are tireless, they're industrious, they're always jumping around. But you know what? They don't really plant any seed, and they don't harvest any grain. And yet the Heavenly Father feeds them. They don't store up treasures, but yet God uses and he feeds them, and yet they sing praises to their Creator. He said, I want you to learn from them. One writer said it really in a profound way, kind of caught my attention. He says, you never notice birds trying to build a bigger nest or more nests than their neighbor, their other birds. You never see a squirrel that gets like heart disease or heart attack because he doesn't store enough nuts for two winters instead of one. And you definitely don't see bears being envious of one another because the cave in which they're hibernating is bigger or smaller than their neighbor. And you definitely don't see a dog losing sleep because he hasn't stored enough bones for his retirement years, right? So you see this simple illustration. It's very powerful, isn't it? So he's basically telling us from the very word that the worry is a sin. I want you to hear that, North Sea Baptist. Worry is a sin. Command from God three times in this passage, do not worry. Why is it a sin? Because we fail to trust our Creator. We fail to trust the one who not only created us, but also provides for us. Now, some of you are very logical in your thinking, so I think you'll appreciate these lines of arguments that Jesus provides in this passage, where Jesus argues what I would call in verse 25, from the greater to the lesser. So what's the greater? He says, look at your life. That's the greater. And if God created your life and gave you life, will he not provide the lesser, the food and the drink, to support that? Then he says, look at your body. And God obviously created our body. And if God created your body and my body, would he not also provide the clothing on it? Then verse 26, he argues what I would call from the lesser to the greater, where he uses the birds. And he says, if I'm taking care of the birds of the air and you're made in his image, how much more important are we than the birds? And if God feeds them, will he not take care of us as well? Now, a lot of times, and especially when we were the second country affected with COVID right outside of China, we were the number two nation in numbers for a long, long time. The image started coming up as the COVID began to spread that this is a war. It's an invisible enemy, obviously the virus, right? But this writer put a parallel about worry and war and being a soldier, and I think many of us can identify. So if you can imagine yourself being in war and you're a soldier, and yes, we are fighting this invisible virus. But as we're doing this, he says, imagine yourself a soldier. He says, now, if you're a soldier, you're either mobile or immobile. But if you're mobile, there's no reason to worry. If you're immobile, you cannot move, then one of two things is for certain. Either you're in your own territory where you're safe, or you're in the enemy's territory. Now, if you're in your own territory, no need to worry. But if you're in the enemy's territory, one of two things are for certain. Either you're in a place that is protected and the enemy cannot see you, or you're in a place of exposure and you're endangered. And if you're in a protected place, no need to worry. But if you're in a place of danger, one of two things are for certain. That if you're there, either you are wounded or you're not wounded. If you're not wounded, no need to worry. If you're wounded, one of two things are for certain. Either you are wounded seriously or you're wounded slightly. If you're wounded slightly, no need to worry. But if you're wounded seriously, one of two things are for certain. That either you're going to recover or you're going to die. If you recover, no need to worry. Guess what? If you die, no worries. Isn't that simple? I love God's word. God takes care of us. The second illustration that he uses and he lays it out for is the body, the clothing. So he used first with life, with the birds. Now he looks at our clothing. And he says, why are you worried in verse 28 about your clothing? And then he says, observe. That word observe, again, is not glancing. It's to look with intentionality, to look with intensity, to pay attention to what? The lilies of the field. And then he says, these lilies of the field that neither toil nor spin. Yet I say to you, Solomon, all of his glory, did not clothe himself as one of these. It's an amazing story, right? So he's using these lilies to give us an example that they, what do? They just grow and they bloom and beautiful, right? And God says, compared to Solomon, who was the richest man ever, right? He had all these gorgeous robes and the crowns, but they can't compare. I love lilies that don't compare, nor that they complain, right? About their clothing or who has what and who doesn't have what. And so God's word is telling us from his word, again, an argument from the lesser of the greater. If he's going to clothe and take care of the lilies, will he not clothe you? Look what it says in verse 30. If God so raised and clothes the grass that's alive today, but tomorrow is sown in the furnace, how much more will he clothe you? You have little faith. Now, I think for us, he's not telling us not to work. He's just telling us to work, but don't worry. He wants us to be obedient to his command to work, but to work with faith, trusting and obeying God. And that's what he will do. Now, most of us will say, Pastor, it's really easy not to worry when everything's going well, right? The problem is when things are not going well. I think many of you might appreciate the story that comes out of Germany post-war, 1946 to 48. This particular sermon by pastor by the name of Helmut Tellick was preaching a sermon series on the Sermon on the Mount. And he comes across this passage and he's going to say, you know, how this carefree life that Jesus seems to be proposing to believers, how does that apply to us in post-war Germany? He says, we still have fresh memories of air raids and our houses collapsing and the fire and all the damage that's been done to us. But then he says, I had to look back at the life of Christ. And the life of Christ was no bird-like or lily-like existence. But he still calls us to live carefree, worry-free. But then it struck him, as his pastor of post-war Germany says, you know what? As he's given the Sermon of the Mount to not worry, the shadow of the cross was actually looming over him, knowing that all of humanity's sin was hanging in the balance in our salvation, and he was going to ultimately die for us. And he still calls us to be carefree. I want you to hear this. God has not given us trouble-free life, suffering-free life, persecution-free life. He's not telling us not to have work or not to have responsibility, but he is telling us we can, as believers, be worry-free. But then he says at the end of verse 30, he says, you have little faith. Wow. He never says that to unbelievers, by the way, or pre-believers, as we call them in Singapore. He only addressed you have little faith to people who actually follow him. Three times it's used, ye of little faith. And the first one is obviously here, but in Matthew chapter 8 is the second one. When Matthew chapter 8, the disciples are having what we would call an anxiety attack or a mental breakdown in the boat with the storm when Jesus was sleeping. And he wakes up, he calms the storm. He says, ye of little faith. Matthew 14 is the second instance. When Peter's walking in the water, which requires a lot of faith, by the way, but remember, divided mind, distracted. And the storms, the waves, begin to get his attention, and he begins to sink. And what does Jesus say to him? He has a little faith. But then in Matthew chapter 16, they're short on food, supplies. And he says, you have a little faith. One writer says it better than I could ever say it. He says this, worry is practical atheism and is an affront to God. I want you to hear that again. Worry is practical atheism. What do I mean by that? Well, when you worry, you discount God. You refuse to put God in the equation of your thoughts, your mind. You're fragmented, you're scattered, you're divided, which means God is taken out of the equation. So I want you to hear how serious this is. When we worry, we sin. Not only do we sin, we actually practice practical atheism, and it is a affront to God. So he calls us not to worry. So what's the solution as he's calling us to faith? Well, we're going to have to replace worry with what? Trust in God. As we get to the final point in verses 33, and verse 32, I forgot to mention, he says, don't be like the Gentiles. I mean, Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, but your Heavenly Father knows you need all these things. So when we act like this out of worry, we actually imitate the Gentiles, that we're just like them. And so God is telling us, don't do that. The Father knows what you need. Then we get to the last one, as you see the point in front of you. Replace worry with trust in God. We're going to do it backwards, so we're going to go to verse 34. Verse 34 says, do not worry about tomorrow. Remember, there are three commands. Do not worry, verse 25, verse 31. Now, verse 34. Do not worry about tomorrow. Now, I'm 6 hours ahead of you, so my tomorrow will be here a little bit faster, but it says still, do not worry. Why? Again, do not be divided about your future. Do not have a divided mind. Do not have a fractured focus. Do not have a scattered spirit about what's going to happen tomorrow. There's an unknown. Why? Because the one who's saying this to you is actually eternal. And the future, the tomorrow, securely in his hands. So maybe we ought to put it like this in practical words. Live every day in total and absolute dependence and trust in him. Why? Because he holds our tomorrow. He's eternal. And he said tomorrow will take care of itself. Each day has enough troubles of its own, doesn't it not? It does, doesn't it? So he's calling us in this area. And so I think, let me kind of put it in maybe these terms that have really helped me. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 6 a little bit earlier? He says, give us this day our daily bread. He doesn't say give us our monthly bread. Give us our annual bread, but daily bread. So he's teaching us to walk by faith. But there's something that happens when we worry about tomorrow. In fact, I think when we worry about tomorrow, what happens with the fears and anxieties and the unknowns, all of those things that are equated in, we actually experience it today. So when we worry about tomorrow, we experience tomorrow today, and all of a sudden it gets loaded up. There's an author by the name of George MacDonald. He says it better than I could say it. He says, no man ever sunk into the burden of today. No one. It is only when tomorrow's burden is added to today that it becomes overwhelming. Maybe God's promise, you need to remember God's promise, is that he'll give you enough strength for today and for the trouble today, but he will not give you enough strength for the worry of the struggle or the worry today. So now we come to really the key. So how do you combat worry? I think sometimes when you tell, don't you love it when there are some people out there who are what we call worry warts or people who are worriers? How many of you are worry people? Don't point at your husband right now or your wife, but how many of you love it when you who worry say, people come up and say, don't worry? Like that doesn't really solve the problem, right? Just by you, somebody telling me not to worry. But what do you replace it with? Look at verse 33. Seeking the kingdom of God first. Many of us are very familiar with this verse, and my sister prayed this prayer just a moment ago. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Now that word seeking is a command, so it's not optional again. But the word seeking also means to pursue. It means to go after. It's impossible to seek. It's impossible to pursue if you're stationary and you're status quo. That you actually have to get up and move. You have to pursue. You have to go after. There has to be some changes inside of you for us to seek something. You can't seek something stationary, status quo. You have to move. And so God's word is telling us to seek. So what's the object of our seeking? And by the way, that seeking is ongoing. It's not just when we're in a worship service at North Sea Baptist, whether virtually or in person. It means that when you go home tonight and tomorrow, the next day, you keep seeking. That's what it means, ongoing seeking. So what do you seek? Seek the kingdom of God. Now, most people sadly think the kingdom of God is something that is geographically up in heaven, or it's a position or a place, but that's actually a minor part of it. The major part of the kingdom of God, it talks about the rule of the realm of God. Let me put it in our terms. Seek the control of God in your life. Every Christian has their own realm. Now, I promise you, I have three sons, all right? And I'm telling you, my control over them is minimal. And during this COVID-19, David knows this, but my son was supposed to get married ready. I was supposed to leave today from Singapore to go to do get my last son. We call it the Omega wedding. And he was supposed to be getting married on June the 20th. But all the shutdown, we can't fly out of Singapore. If we do, we can't fly back. Shepherd doesn't leave a sheep during a pandemic and all this stuff, right? And so I couldn't go. And so my son, instead of like delaying the wedding, like from June 20th until we get there, guess what he does? He moves it forward, May the 16th. And in this room that you see me filming now is where I actually perform my son's wedding virtually. Let me tell you, there are things out of our control, like my son's, and some of you can identify with that as well. So what's our realm? The realm is your influence, your sphere, and where you operate. What do you have to say about your responses to people, your words that you say, whether or not you're going to trust in your heart, whether or not you're going to read the word, whether or not you're going to have a critical spirit or negative, whether or not you're going to be full of doubt or fragmented focus or scattered spirit? That's your realm. And God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God in your realm, that you are the one that are yielding to the rule and the reign of God in your control. And that's what he means. Now, the challenge is, it's going to be our choice, his kingdom or my kingdom. Which one are you going to choose? And so God is asking us to yield, to submit, even our children, our work, our church, this pandemic, the racial riots are taking place all over the U.S. Are we going to yield to his realm and to his rule? Secondly, look what it says, seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness. Now, most undoubtedly, righteousness is synonymous with his kingdom because his kingdom is righteous. But in the Old Testament, righteousness was often paralleled with, ready for this, social injustice, cruelty, slave trade, poverty, just oppression of the people who are in poverty. So I think God is calling us, his kingdom citizens, is yielding to his kingdom and rule, that we as a church must speak, that we as a church must act with the king speaking through us on these social injustices. This is very close to my heart to see all the things that are going on. But you know, sometimes we look, oh, that's the U.S., that's the West, that's the wild, wild West, right? All Norwegians and Singaporeans would say that's the wild West. But do you know there are racial divides here in Singapore? There are social and economic divides. There's the foreign workers that are put into another class. There's domestic workers. It's a social divide. It depends what ethnicity, what race you are. It's a very challenging part. But God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. Now, let me encourage you as we close up here that you pursue this with every bit of energy and earnestness that God will give you. Don't let this pandemic go to waste. Let that pandemic shape your heart in order that you pursue, that we ought to wake up with this relentless spirit. Let me close with this illustration. I think you'll appreciate that, especially as we heard the story from South Africa. In Africa, if you are a gazelle, use your imagination, if you're a gazelle, you're going to wake up every morning with one goal, that you would run faster than the fastest lion in order to save your life. If you're a lion, you're going to wake up with one goal, that you want to run faster than the slowest gazelle, or else you will starve to death. Now know this, when the sun comes up, you better be running. Doesn't matter if you're a lion or a gazelle. I love what Spurgeon says, if you're not seeking the kingdom of God, and that's with persistence and consistency, the devil is seeking you. Hear that well. I want to close with this challenge. Are you a warrior? Have you trusted God? Have you released? Look at God. Look at his nature. Look at the birds. Look at the lilies of the field. If God will feed and take care of them, how much more will he take care of you? Do not worry. You're more important than the lilies. You're more important than the birds. Then he calls us, says, don't be like the Gentiles. Don't practice practical atheism and put God and remove God out of the equation of your mind and your thinking and your focus and your spirit. And then keep moving. Get up and seek. You know, we've been confined. We're still confined. Singapore, we're going to probably be virtual all the way until December, by the way, so it's a challenge here in Singapore. But I have a new grandson, which I can't see yet due to this. But I love him because what he does, he swivels. So he moves around like this. He likes doing that. Martin Luther King, many of you recognize his name really well. He says, if you do not fly, cannot fly, we cannot here in Singapore, then you need to run. If you cannot run, walk. If you cannot walk, crawl, but by all means, keep moving. And I would add, keep seeking. Now, even if you can't crawl, I would add my grandson, swivel. Just shift around and make sure that you hear and you minister to those around you, that you encourage your family members, that you pray for them, that you share the love of God, that you pray with a spirit of trust and confidence that God will cover you. I want to close with prayer over you, that God would replace your anxiety and your worry with kingdom peace. Let me pray for you now. Father, we are so thankful and so grateful for your word that teaches and that shows us exactly what we need. Father, we pray that as you continue to show and let your word come alive inside of each one of us, Father, that we would be living examples of not practical atheism, but a living and real and true Christianity, of Christ in us, the hope of glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.